everybody here can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast. Your hosts, James Gable and Brandon Thompson, are here to bring you enlightenment to the topic of communication.
Good morning, Brandon.
Good morning, James.
It's morning.
It is morning.
It's a rarity.
It is a rarity. It's the morning after the boys' watch party, because the boys drops every Friday. Also, quality show. Not for the faint of heart, but a quality show nonetheless. Amazon, if you want to pay me for that plug, you're welcome.
Yep, this plug brought to you by Amazon.
Yeah, Prime specifically. Anyway, so I've got my Celsius that I call ever-loving cellulose to get me going and get up in the morning. James has his shaken espresso.
Yeah, thank you for the shaken espresso this morning, Bryn.
Yeah, got you.
Get us going this morning. Well, yes. This morning, today, this episode.
This episode, this morning.
We are going to talk about training the uncommon way. This is kind of part two of our training concept that we had in episode 29. And also, this is a big deal. We hit episode 30 today, as well as we zoomed past, and we forgot to mention it last week, 1,000 downloads.
Whew. Yeah. We got a grand in the bank, bro.
Remember when we were shooting for 7 episodes?
I do. Well, yeah, because 7 was the big deal. It was the cutoff for most podcasts that you just didn't make it past 7.
Yeah, 7 episodes is the average of the 20 million podcasts that have been started in the world. They average about 7 episodes long. So congratulations.
Yeah.
Virtual shaking of the hands. High five. But we want to talk about the uncommon way. This is something we have been our theme throughout our podcast, which is talking about being an uncommon communicator.
Mm-hmm.
And the two tenets of that uncommon communicator is both enlightenment and then really taking ownership of our conversations. And we highlight those in each of our episodes, especially an enlightenment, moment of enlightenment for the day. But also we talk about those ownership, which is really a combination lock to unlock your communications, own it. And there's ways to unlock it. So there's a set of skills that we kind of try to highlight every time in every episode that we have.
Yeah, because any idiot can just regurgitate information when trying to train somebody. But to actually be a good teacher and or a good trainer, you need to do, we believe you need to do this the uncommon way, focusing on enlightenment and ownership.
That is correct. Now, the word enlightenment, oddly enough, and I believe I tell the story that kind of got us to this point of where I came up with this idea of enlightenment. I shared it about my boss, and my boss was like, enlightenment. I'm like, hold on a minute. And then
it's all about vulnerability, not enlightenment.
That's a different topic. But I shared with him the idea that, you know, you have to know that there's a conversation going on. And then his eyes lit up, and I'm like, boom, done. Enlightenment. But the idea of it still scares people. The word kind of scares people, which is interesting because really it's not what I perceived. When we picture enlightenment, we picture somebody off in India kind of floating up in the air with his legs crossed in some deep meditation.
Hasn't eaten a meal in 7 days.
Yes, or longer.
Yeah.
Right, and he's communing with the universe.
Mm-hmm.
So the word can be scary to some folks, but really it's all about having, this is the definition, having or showing a rational, modern, and well-informed outlook.
Huh.
Who wouldn't want that?
It has nothing to do with floating in the air and not eating for 7 days straight.
None of the above.
It has everything to do with an open mind and a perspective and an ability to learn, listen, understand. And then we take it a step further with the ownership. But yeah, like that's the point of enlightenment.
And I think for me, the journey of these last 29 episodes has really helped me to...
Now you're starting to sound hippy-dippy.
Journey. We're on a journey.
Should I sit cross-legged for this?
I thought you were.
My legs are crossed, but I'm not sitting cross-legged.
But the idea is on this... Yes, I'm going to get hippy-dippy on you.
Okay.
But this journey for me, as you've opened my mind to this marketplace of ideas, never heard that term before, never really thought about it. And I've had a conversation with somebody even recently about how doing the podcast for me has really opened my mind to a lot of things. I never thought I would have embraced or understood the background on the pronoun thing when you approach that. That for me, that was a, hey, but does it really hurt to call somebody what they want to be called? You know, that certainly goes against a lot of stuff that's ingrained within me. That's just one in particular. But the idea that that marketplace of ideas, let's share some ideas, let's get some enlightenment and not get so stuck in our ways that we're bound to, you know, our, you know,
I was like, we're
putting chains on ourselves.
Yeah, you're learning and growing on a constant basis, right? They tell you to like learn something every day, right? If you're not necessarily enlightened, you probably don't learn something every day. Like you're not continuing to grow. That's the point of this. And that's the point of like an uncommon communicator is you're continually learning, perfecting the art of your communication, just kind of being a, necessarily being like a better human being, but in being a better communicator tends to lead to better things.
It doesn't tend, it does. I'm going to cut your soft, mushy word, hippie word out of it.
Oh, okay.
It does lead to bigger and better things.
Well, there you go.
Being a better communicator. One quote, though, that I ran across, and this is a shout out to Julie Cooley. She's a friend of mine. She's a Toastmaster.
Wait, Julie Cooley?
Julie Cooley.
K or C?
C.
C, like C-O-O-L-I?
I don't know how to spell.
Oh, okay. Well, Julie, you can now listen to the podcast and tell us how to spell your name later. Leave a comment, please.
A comment and we'll share it with everybody. She shared this on Facebook and it was kind of an Indian.
It's a little hippy dippy like quote here. Yeah,
it was we think it isn't always, but it was really a fantastic quote and I'm going to read it. Enlightenment is a destructive process. It has nothing to do with becoming better or being happier.
As we literally just said, it leads to better things, but it's okay. Continue.
Enlightenment is the crumbling away of untruth.
Ah.
It's seen through the facade of pretense. It's the complete eradication of everything we imagined to be true.
Is it the key word in there is imagined?
And that is a quote by Adyashanti.
Adyashanti.
Yep. He's a deep thinker out of the California area.
Mm-hmm.
But that quote really was pretty powerful, I think, mm-hmm. to me. And it was, and I think you disagreed with me, I think a little dramatic, right? It's, you know, this destructive process, but it's true. There's a lot of things within the idea of enlightenment that you have to take what you're stuck in. This is this marketplace of ideas and take on some other thoughts, some other ideas. So you have to destroy those ideas that are clouding your mind.
Yeah. So everybody kind of walks in with their preconceived notions, right? Pretense is in the quote specifically. So you have your pretense, you have your biases, you have all this other stuff. And enlightenment is to understand that these things, to see for what it actually is versus not what you believe it to be. Right. And you can take that in many different corners and many different avenues. The uncommon communicator is specifically taking it through communication and through effective communication. Right. So you have to strip away all of your preconceived notions of the individual that you're talking with or of the circumstances that you're talking with this individual for. Right. And once you just see it for what it is and just kind of like lay it bare, then that's when true communication can occur and when true enlightenment does happen. And that's when you get your points across. And that's when the light bulb comes on. And that's when training is effective.
It's all about that light bulb. And this other line really is powerful to me. Enlightenment is the crumbling away of untruth.
Right? As it, those preconceived notions. When you walk into a room and you see somebody that's got like a patriot's hat on, you look at him and you're like, oh man, what a jerk. No, I'm a good person. I promise. Although, does any good person ever say that they're a good person?
No, not publicly.
Not publicly. No one ever.
Or put it on a T-shirt.
T-shirt. Yeah, I'm a good person. But like you know, you have preconceived notions that come in there, and the fact of the matter is that it's probably just not true.
And you know, as we've talked a lot about truth as part of this podcast as well too, but something I've listened to recently has really kind of changed my mind on changing your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what that kind of speaks to me as well, too, is this crumbling away of untruth. We a lot of times think that our truth is the only truth.
Mm-hmm.
And to have that now, you may believe something. It basically, the quote came down to, if I haven't changed my mind, then I'm stuck in my ways. So they look to be proven wrong.
Mm-hmm.
They want to be proven wrong because then they're smarter and have more information. So it's having that willingness. Like, so many people want to defend their truth. This was a whole concept of I want to be able to be proven wrong. And guess who it was? It was our friend Kahneman.
Oh, good old Kahneman?
Yeah. There was a quote that somebody was referring back to he went out to lunch with him. It was a kind of a weird story, but he went out and had lunch and talked with our friend Kahneman, who we've talked about is, deep into the psychology of something. He was really smart guy with quotes.
Kahneman's a smart. He's a smart cookie. He knows his own.
But it goes back to that guy who wants to always be learning new truth and is willing to accept the fact that what you might have known before is now thought of as wrong. Mm-hmm. It's seen through the facade of pretense. I mean, that's just a very fancy word that he used there, right?
So your preconceived notions and or your biases walking in. That's what you're looking things through, but no. It gets stripped away. It gets destroyed through enlightenment.
Yeah, a facade, like a fake front, right? Mm-hmm. And then pretense. We know plenty of pretentious people. I don't want to say. I know.
I was like, we won't give out names.
No names named here. And this is where I think he just makes the point again. It's the complete eradication of everything we imagined to be true. And that's willing to accept another side. Yeah. Accept another form of truth. That brings you to that point of enlightenment. Mm-hmm. So the key to enlightenment is really, it seems simple, but it's the starting place. And that's why within our mantra as well, it has to start with enlightenment. You have to be at the place where you notice that communication isn't going on. You have to have that moment of enlightenment.
Well, how many people have gotten up and given us? So I think I gave this, I didn't give this example in the training, right? But when you were in school, you got up and you gave a speech or you gave a lecture or you gave like a presentation, right? And as you're giving this presentation, you get to the end and you're supposed to ask the class, does anybody have any questions, right? How many people got to the end of the conversation and or got to the end of the lecture and no one raised their hand to ask a question? It probably means that when that happens, the audience is not engaged. No one has been enlightened and you just blew hot air for however long your presentation was.
Yeah, you've worn them out.
Yeah.
Right? Nobody was enlightened. If the light bulb went off, you pretty much ran out of energy to keep it running.
I was like, well, yeah. So, right? So people would have been engaged. If the light bulb went on, people would be engaged, and then they would ask questions at the very end. So pro tip, if no one asked questions after your presentation, they weren't listening.
They weren't listening.
They were not enlightened.
Or you got right up to the end. All right, we have 10 seconds for questions. No questions? Let's move on.
I was like, as long as somebody raises their hands, then you know they're engaged. But if nobody, you can skip over the questions because then you know they're engaged. There you go.
There you go. Well, we have 4 points in the key to enlightenment. And one was just that, it seems simple, but it's the starting place. It has to start with enlightenment. The second one is this is really the start of emotional intelligence and self-regulation. You're emotionally intelligent when you can have that ability to recognize whether those conversations are going on. Mm-hmm.
And emotionally intelligent to understand what's going on with the other person too, right? You have to, it sounds dumb, but communication is like you're trying to make a connection with somebody else, right? Like you're trying to get on the same wavelength as someone else. You have to be emotionally intelligent to control your emotions, understand your emotions, and then understand the other person's emotions and not necessarily control their emotions, but navigate through their emotions and all that stuff with the conversation.
Yep. And you're jumping ahead. Communication is only a two-way street if both are enlightened.
Mm-hmm.
Does take two.
Yeah. Well, a person's got to raise their hand. At the end of your presentation, that person has to raise their hand and probably ask a question. Otherwise, they didn't retain a lot of that information.
And you didn't interest them. You didn't engage them.
No. Because think about the times where you've like been in class or like you're interested in something. You always ask more questions. You always do. Because you want to know more and you care. When you don't care and you don't want to know more, what do? Not ask questions.
And then the last thing is really the communicator must be fully invested to ensure communication takes place. You first have to know it's not going on. But as part of that enlightenment, you've got to be fully invested in that. And this is something that isn't going to happen every time. I've been there plenty of times where you're like, this isn't worth the effort. This isn't going to get what the main point is going to be there. This mm-hmm. isn't that important of a deal. And this is going to take a lot longer than just a couple of seconds to get past it. We're all been there, and that's okay. But that's part of growing. But there are important conversations that I think get overlooked because we don't want to take the time. We're not fully invested in it. We get angry. Our emotions get involved. And we're not fully vested to see that communication all the way through.
Yeah, no. And the uncommon communicator is invested to make sure that it does happen, right? Like, it's not going to be like, oh, well, I trained this guy and he didn't turn out too great, but the next one will be just fine. No, the uncommon communicator is invested in like every trainer that or every trainee. Because, again, I don't know. In my job specifically, anybody can do it. There hasn't been anybody that I haven't seen been able to do it. In the trades, I can tell you right now, I'm not a welder. I know for a fact I can't be a welder. But, you know,
you
I think,
could be. But
no,
you're not currently.
I do.
Mm-hmm. Hand-eye coordination?
There's patience involved with welding, and you almost need hands of a surgeon to be a welder. And I'm here to tell you right now, the couple welds that I tried and the like 2 hours that the teacher took to just try and get me to do like a basic little thing. He looked at me, he's like, it's going to take a lot more and I wouldn't recommend welding as a career. And I'm like, you know.
Wow, that was early on.
Well, he understood what I was going for a career for or whatever. And he's just like, Brandon, we're going to get you through this class. But if you want to continue to do welding, you're going to need a lot more than this class.
Well, and that comes down to, and I was a certified welder in my previous life, as I like to call it, structural vertical overhead 1-inch plate. But I spent an entire summer welding. So that came down to practice.
Yeah.
And that's if you don't enjoy doing that, then you're not going to enjoy the practice that went into it to be an expert at something. Tying that back to our communication, there is that, hey, you know, we all have to do this.
Well, yeah. So, and we talked about the trainee at the very end of our last episode, right? The trainee has to also be invested. And one of the ways that a trainee can be invested is by having a good teacher, right? Like, how many times have you gone to a class where you're like, dude, I hate math. And then you get the crazy teacher, not necessarily the crazy teacher, but you get the teacher that is just as invested in your knowledge of math, or is almost more invested in your knowledge of math or whatever subject it is than you are. And then it kind of like encourages you to do it, right? And like I said, could I have spent a summer welding? Maybe. Was I invested to do it? Not really. I enjoyed the woodworking stuff more than I enjoyed the welding stuff, right?
You don't like hot sparks flying on your arms?
Not my go-to, you know, the light and the blinding stuff. But it was one of those where, and I also appreciate the man telling me the truth, looking at me, he's like, hey, man, you're going to need a lot of work. So here's what you're going to need to do to get through like the class. Because again, he's teaching functional skills, and this is like an advanced class, so welding is not normally taught. But that's neither here nor there. He was a vested teacher, and in being vested, he looked at me. He's like, "Hey, look, man, you're going to need more than what I can do in this class if you want to be a welder. But let's like get you through this, right?" So that to me, that is a vested teacher properly communicating to me that I need more help than he can offer, right? And then that's an enlightened moment between the two of us where we understand that, you know what, Brandon, maybe this ain't for you. And that's fine.
That is fine. Because right. We have to know that. We're not experts at everything.
No.
Although I've met some who say they are.
Well, hi.
Experts.
Never
as
wrong.
As a comment, never wrong as a comment about everything. Yeah. Just some people I know. But the uncommon communicator takes the idea of enlightenment really to that level of having to have that, you know, understanding that communication needs to continue. Mm-hmm. The other aspect is the ownership. We own that conversation all the way to the end, being that we're going to take our skills and those skills are going to help drive to a mutual understanding. And that's mm-hmm. how we've worded it in our mantra. But the idea was it's a combination lock. Like the first one's a key. The key, you got to put the key in, enlightenment. Mm-hmm. Seems simple. Keys, easy, switch. Now, combination lock takes, you know, different combinations for different people. And that's the important part of the skills that we've been talking about over the last 30 episodes, 29 episodes, is what are those skills? And we're going to continue to build them as mm-hmm. we move forward as well, too. But within those, that combination lock, mm-hmm. really there were three things that we identified. One was how do people speak? And we've talked a lot about that. Mm-hmm. How do you listen? What type mm-hmm. of listener are you? And what's your emotional state? You take those three items, find that combination, and then with your skills, you can facilitate that conversation mm-hmm. to a mutual understanding.
I was like, and then, you know, and the other part to ownership is that when it doesn't happen, you need to understand that, like, to say it's your fault's not wrong, but, like, you need to say, hey, look, I did not deliver on, like, what was promised, right? Like, if you're training somebody and they don't get it, you need to be the, like, you need to step up and say, hey, look, I could have done this better. Like, how do I need to go back and fix this? As opposed to, well, no, he just didn't get it. Or, you know, so-and-so just didn't get it. I talked to him. I tried. Whatever. It's not my problem. As an uncommon communicator, as an uncommon trainer, you take responsibility for the lack of communication or that lack of enlightenment. Right. And that's the uncommon way. Cause how many times have you seen somebody go through like a training program and you just kind of like fake it when you get out of the end? You're like, yeah. Blah.
Yeah. And a lot of our training programs we do have such a minimum low passing. Sometimes they're not even a pass or fail. You've completed a duration. What are you really getting out of something like that? You know, if you just have to complete a duration and move on, there's no skills test. There's no check of that at all. And some of the percentages are like 70%. You know, you pass with this with 70%, pretty low numbers.
Yeah.
You know, there's a term, I believe it's called D's get you degrees.
C's get degrees, D's for diploma.
Oh, okay.
So you need a diploma is what you get from high school, right? And then degrees what you get from college. So you need a D to get through high school. You need a C to get through college.
And the thing with the
whole... Also, my mantra in high school and in college.
Worked well for you, didn't it?
I got a piece of paper that says I know things, darn it.
One thing, we've got interns that are working for us right now that are going to finish up their last semester after the summer. And then they go back to school. And the interning is always, it's a job application. It's a, you know, it's kind of a job trial, basically.
You know, we're going to attempt to take you on and possibly teach you these skills. And ideally, if you learn the skills by the end, we might have a job opening for you.
Well, even that, like we never go back and think, all right, if you get a B or better in, you know, system dynamics, then we might hire you. Nobody goes back and looks at those grades.
No, they don't.
And that's why I wish I knew the things I knew 40 years ago or so.
10 years ago. It's been 10 years for James.
Yeah, I've been out of high school 10 years ago plus. But the idea is that whole learning idea, the more I've learned is more important than the grades that you get. Mm-hmm. But the grades, you know, kind of show your ability to learn. Are you a learner? Are you teachable? And then did you have good teachers?
Well, but did you put in the work is kind of the way I've always... So the way I've always equated school versus like life experience has always been... Because you can go to a job, right, and someone can take you on and say that I'm going to teach you how to do this and whatnot, right? But school proves that you are teachable, where this is more of a let's just try, run, error, see if it works. And then either way, that person then learned that, you know, okay, what I did here was wrong, what I did there was wrong. And you learn, God, no, I can't weld, right? So that's just and both of those are life experiences that you now walk away from and that you've learned something with. All right, I learned that I'm not a very good, not necessarily tradesman, but like can't do welding. Probably just need to not do that. I learned that. He learned that right away, that kind of a thing. So it's important to get these life experiences and know these things. But school, the realm of school is that like you are teachable, you have a work ethic, and that you are willing to learn is, I think, what school demonstrates. Is that's the important part of school. But jumping right in, absolutely nothing wrong with it.
I wish they would teach more about being that lifelong learner.
Okay.
I've learned more even in the last 2 years than I did in the previous 5 years before that. But always learning, I think, is the key. And that's one thing that you'll know, you know, when we hit our 1,000 episodes, I challenged everybody. I posted this on LinkedIn to go back and listen to our first one. We're keeping it there.
Yeah.
Because that you look at that one, you know, 31, 32 weeks ago when we did this, you and I have grown a lot just in this process, in this portion of communication, and everybody can, which is what that says.
Yeah.
But talking about the combination lock, there's three things. How do you speak? We spend a lot of time talking about that. Are you assertive? Are you an aggressive? Are you passive?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, our ever famous passive aggressive.
Shh.
You have to identify how are they speaking to you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what approach are they taking? You're an assertive.
Yep.
I believe that I fall under the passive side. I'm certainly, there's some people that are going to say passive aggressive, yes, but those kind of people just don't know what they're talking about.
He says passive aggressively.
But you want to see what kind of energy are they coming at you with. And then the next one is, how do they listen? So you've got to do a little bit of assessment of that individual. Mm-hmm. There, and this is, I like this. Some people are like, tell me more. You know, I want more. I want more information. Some are, tell me less. And I equate it to the soup Nazi from Seinfeld. Mm-hmm. It's like, what do you want? Move along. That's all they want. Some people want a bunch of facts and information. Mm-hmm. The others are just, give me the short version of this. Other people are, I need facts. I need numbers. I need charts. Help me understand this by that assessment. And then the fourth one, some people need stories. Stories is what's going to connect to them, spreadsheets or not. So you need to kind of identify what kind of listener are they. And we talked a little bit about this on what kind of, how teachable are they and what are those different teachable styles. But the third one is really, in my opinion, kind of the most important one, is what emotional state are they in? Because if somebody is really excited and angry, and we've talked a lot about this through our talks through negotiation, you've got to slow it down.
Yeah, no, I was like, because you have to, depending on someone's emotional state, they're going to listen to things differently, or they're going to hear things differently. Not necessarily listen to things differently, but they're going to hear things differently and perceive things differently. So you need to adjust your communication to their emotional state to make sure that they are that your point and your knowledge and your understanding of this is then imparted on them, as opposed to it's like when you're like, oh, I thought that's what you meant. Not when you're like, no, I meant this. And they're like, oh, I thought you meant this. As a communicator, and some of that can be the emotional state, right? Like, an emotional state can play a big factor in that. You need them to do exactly what you mean, not what they think you mean. And an uncommon communicator knows that the enlightenment occurred, that they know exactly what you mean, and that they go and then do it. And if it doesn't happen, then you take ownership. You say, okay, clearly maybe it was their emotional state. Clearly I didn't communicate properly with your emotional state. Maybe I didn't like communicate with your listening style, that different kinds of things. And you need to know that, and you need to go back and be like, all right, now let me redirect and let me fix this properly.
And one thing I've learned over the years is there's things that we hold as the absolute and how to do it. And there are certainly things that you have to do it this mm-hmm. way. You'd better put that AED on the right way. Put it on the wrong body parts. It's not going to get what you want if you're trying to save lives. So there's specific things that we do that have to be done the right way. There's so many other things that don't have to be done your way. You know, the old my way or the highway thing. Mm-hmm. There's allowing the listener, finding out where they're at and letting them come to the conclusions and do something differently as part of that communication really gets a better result, because then there's buy-in on it. Mm-hmm. But you're having to understand exactly where they're at emotionally. If they're calm, they're listening. You know, we said angry isn't good. If they're super emotional, sometimes it's good to calm the emotions down. Mm-hmm. And as we've said before, even in the angry emotional, sometimes time away is the best way.
Yeah.
No. Right. And then the last one is being just cold. You know, somebody's got their arms crossed. You have to, as the communicator, find out what's going to break that wall down. Mm-hmm. Another one that maybe you need some time away, but for the most part, you got to have that conversation, find out what those keys are or that combination to get them to relax, to be receptive to your message.
You have to get them to be able to be engaged. The arms are folded, they're not engaged. If they're like angry or upset with you, then they're probably not going to listen to what you have to say, or they'll just fake it and then move on, right?
Well, and I've seen it on the other side of that, though. I've seen people angry, plenty of people, emotional. On the other side of that, there is a ton of communication that happens if you're skilled enough to get them there. Mm-hmm. Because with all of that passion, you get them through that emotion, you kind of talk them through that, and then you get to a point where you're really talking about where you're headed. It's almost like a more receptive, you know, like I'm going to equate this to, you know, cooking meat. Mm-hmm. They've been tenderized a little bit. Yeah. You know, they've been able to process through that toughness. Mm-hmm. And then there's a point of even more receptivity and acknowledgement. And on the other side of that anger sometimes is the enlightenment.
There you go. Listen, but you got to work through the emotions to get them there. And you have to know that they are engaged and being receptive to what you're saying.
Correct.
Yes.
So having the key and applying the combination to understand the listener will begin the process of identifying the walls that break down communication. Mm-hmm. Key, combination lock, uncommon communicator.
And that's how you train people too. The uncommon one.
It ties right in, doesn't it?
Because, look, I've said it before, but training is literally just communicating to another person a skill or something. Like, that's all training is. Right? Because it's not like when you train somebody, you're like literally like guiding. Like, there might be times where you're literally like guiding somebody's hand to do something. Very rarely is that the case. Right? Like, you were literally just imparting your wisdom. You're communicating your knowledge to them to get them to effectively do this. It's just a game of telephone. It's all training is. We know how the game of telephones work out.
That's exactly. Better have one line between the two of you.
Yes.
Don't go to that third person even. For me, the moment of enlightenment or UC moment for today is really be uncommon through enlightenment. Mm-hmm. Take ownership of your conversations. Then you become the uncommon communicator.
Very good, James.
That's all I got for today.
That's all I got today.
What about you?
You
already said that.
No, I was like, that's all I got.
You sure? You look like you're questioning.
No. Be uncommon. Understand that, like, you have to take ownership of what's going on. So if you're going to be an uncommon trainer, you have to take ownership of every trainee that you brought into your fold, right? My store manager was like, oh, I don't take responsibility for him. Excuse me? No. Yes, you do. Yeah, you absolutely do. If you train that person, you take responsibility for that person. Because it's your darn fault, right? That's like, I know, and it's a cop-out answer, but you know, like when kids always like blame their teacher, oh, well, my teacher didn't do a good job. Sure. Maybe your teacher didn't communicate the improper way, and they should take ownership of that. But also, as the trainee, did you listen right? Were you an uncommon trainee too? Or is like the teacher just the uncommon communicator?
See, I knew it was brewing up inside of you. So that is all we've got for today.
See you. Bye.